Well, good afternoon, everyone. It's great to be back here at Auburn. War Eagle.
War Eagle.
And it's good to see a couple of friendly faces in the crowd. I have a couple of dear friends in the audience that I haven't seen in a long time. I don't know how this works, but they look much younger and I seem to be getting older. I don't know why that is. My bride and I, Charlene, were both students here years ago. It was a great experience for us, and we have many fond memories from our time here at the university. You see, back when I was a young captain, I was getting ready to go to grad school, and I chose Auburn, in part because it had one of the highest rated counseling departments in the field. I was going back to work at the United States Military Academy, and my field of study was college student development. As I said, Auburn had one of the top rated programs in the country. And there's no question that what I learned here made me a much more effective and more compassionate leader. And so I'm grateful for that. And again, it's always a treat to be able to come back here and spend some time with the wonderful people who make up this very, very special community. And I certainly appreciate the invitation to participate in this esteemed lecture series. Although, truth be told, I do worry a bit because, you know, when people ask you to speak at these sorts of things about your journey, well, that usually means that you're getting old. But the truth is that I do always enjoy talking about the troops that I've led and had the great privilege of serving with over my nearly 41-year career in the military. And I often tell people that I joined the Army because I wanted to serve my country. But I stayed in the Army as long as I did because I love soldiers. I love being around them, and I love watching the incredible lengths that they'll go to support the mission and to support one another. And so I was glad to accept the invitation to come here today to speak to you about them, even if it does mean that I am getting old. Again, I've had the great honor and privilege of serving alongside American sons and daughters of combat during my 3 tours in Iraq and 1 in Afghanistan. I've watched young lieutenants and seasoned non-commissioned officers leading soldiers into battle with little or no regard for their own well-being. Instead, all that they were concerned about was making sure that their troops were doing the right things to safely and successfully conduct their mission. I've sat and watched young officers meeting with district leaders and village elders in remote provinces of Afghanistan, helping them to effectively address tough issues that range from the education of their children, to the shortage of food and water, to security challenges posed by the Taliban insurgents. I've seen young troops, some barely 19 or 20 years old, running towards the sound of the guns and risking their lives, and in some cases, losing their lives, all in order to save the lives of their buddies. And I can assure you that there isn't a more humbling experience in the world, in my opinion. Ladies and gentlemen, this business, the profession of arms, this business is all about people. They are why I have put this uniform on every day for more than 4 decades. And they are what makes ours the greatest and the most powerful military in the world. And of course, we could not do in the military what we do, and especially during periods of prolonged conflict, such as the period that we're currently in, we could not do what we do without the strong and unwavering support of the American people. So up front, Let me thank all of you for what you have done and for what you will continue to do in support of our men and women in uniform, our veterans, our wounded warriors, and their families. We owe you and many, many others a debt of gratitude. So thank you very much. You know, back on September 11, 2001, and as I think about it, many of you were probably only 5 or 6 years old at that time, but back on 9/11, I was serving as the Assistant Division Commander for Maneuver for the 3rd Infantry Division at Fort Stewart, Georgia. That morning, I had just finished PT, or physical training, and I was in my office when we heard the news that a plane had crashed into the World Trade Center in New York City. 17 minutes later, another plane crashed into the adjacent tower. And of course, we are all very familiar with the rest of that tragic story. That day changed our lives forever. Again, many of you were probably only 5 or 6, or maybe even 7 years old at the time. And so our nation has been at war for most of your lives. But I would tell you that the events of that day especially impacted those of us serving in the military. Indeed, some 18 months later, I was in Iraq with the 3rd Infantry Division, helping to lead the initial invasion from Kuwait into Baghdad. Those were interesting times, to say the least. And a whole lot has happened over the years since, both in Iraq and in Afghanistan, and elsewhere throughout the Central Region. And the Central Region consists of 20 countries that make up the Middle East and parts of South and Central Asia. It is one of the most fascinating and at the same time, one of the most complex and dynamic and volatile areas of the world. And numerous challenges emanate from that region seemingly on a daily basis. And yet, as Albert Einstein once famously stated, in the middle of difficulty lies opportunity. And ladies and gentlemen, that is not only how I choose to view the tumultuous Central Region, but it is also how I have viewed every assignment and every challenge that I have faced over the course of my nearly 41-year military career. And that is because while we all must manage problems in our personal and professional lives, opportunities are what enable us to shape outcomes for the future. And so as you go through life, you always want to keep an eye out for the opportunities that may present themselves over time. And pursue those opportunities that will enable you to make a difference. You know, I was here a few months ago, back in November, and I participated in the Forum on World Affairs with Congresswoman Roby. And during that engagement, I talked a lot about what is going on now in Afghanistan and Iraq and Syria and Iran. And I can certainly talk more about those situations during today's question and answer period if you'd like me to. But given the theme of this lecture series, I would like to focus my prepared comments on how to be a leader, an effective leader, a leader in whatever field you choose to pursue. And I'll share with you some of the lessons that I've learned, again, over a military career that has spanned some 4 decades. And in the interest of time, I'll share with you 5 specific lessons that I have learned that have served me well in my life and in my career. You know, back when I was a young second lieutenant, I can remember that I had just completed Ranger School, which is, as some of you know, is a pretty tough school in the Army. And I had completed Ranger School and I had joined my first unit in Germany. And like many brand new second lieutenants, I was ready to take on the world. I wanted to get out there and do great things. And then one day, my platoon sergeant, a gruff, old, non-commissioned officer who had fought in Vietnam, he pulled me aside and he said, "Hey, sir, let me give you a piece of advice. You should worry about one thing and one thing only. Take care of your soldiers, be out in front of them and lead them, and they will do whatever you ask of them, and they will follow you anywhere. And together, you will accomplish amazing things. Important things on behalf of our Army and our nation." And ladies and gentlemen, that advice from Sergeant First Class Fox Ballard has proven time and again to be the most valuable advice of my career. You see, he was absolutely right. For I have found that if you take care of your people, and if you earn their respect, they will move mountains for you. They will amaze and inspire you. And I've seen this demonstrated countless times. As you would imagine, like many who wear this uniform, I've been in a number of tough situations over the years, to include in combat. And there were some particularly rough moments when I would turn to one of my non-commissioned officers and tell him, "Hey, we need to do this. We need to get this done." And typically, before I could finish my sentence, the NCO would say to me, "We got this, sir. We'll get it done." And in fact, they got it done, and they got it done right many more times than not. The fact remains that your troops will do anything that you ask of them. And it's important to note that this advice doesn't simply apply to folks serving in the military. As you go on in your careers, whatever field you pursue, if you're in a leadership position, this advice applies to you as well. The people that you are charged with leading will do anything that you ask of them, but you cannot push them from the rear. You have to lead them, and you have to inspire them. And to do so, the first thing that you have to do is to treat them with dignity and respect. You know, the one thing that people want more than anything else is to be treated fairly and to be treated with respect. And so that is a very big part of taking care of your people. And if you take care of them and if you treat them with respect and lead them, they will follow you anyway. And together you will accomplish amazing things and important things. The second piece of advice that I would offer to you is to always endeavor to be competent and demonstrate confidence. You see, both are equally important. And by the way, I'll talk from my own experiences leading troops. But once again, this same advice applies to leaders outside of the military as well. And the point that I would make to you is that troops, or the folks that you work that work for you, they will listen to every word that you say, but they will watch what you do even more closely. They want to make sure that, number one, you know what you're doing, and that you're competent. And towards this end, by the way, my advice to you is pretty simple. Don't be satisfied with being pretty good. Be the best. Master your craft, whatever that is. And that will require that you put in the requisite amount of effort. You know, any professional athlete will tell you that natural talent is really important, but it will only take you so far. The best athletes in the world, the most successful businessmen and women in the world, and the most effective leaders in the world, they are the best because they are disciplined and because they work incredibly hard. And they will do whatever it takes to master their craft. And so my advice to you is to be willing to do the necessary reps and sets and strive to be the very best in the world at what you do. Again, no matter what that is. As a legendary football coach, Vince Lombardi, once stated, perfection is not attainable. But if we chase perfection, we can catch excellence. End of quote. And that, my friends, is how you ensure confidence. And with confidence comes confidence. And again, the folks who work for you and the folks around you, they will look for that confidence. By the way, I read another great quote the other day, and it said, when the leader lacks confidence, the followers lack commitment. And I believe that that is absolutely true. I'll share one quick related story with you. Back in the spring of 2003, I along with other members of the 3rd Infantry Division command team, were getting ready to lead the division through the Karbala Gap in southern Iraq. This is in the very beginning of the war, Operation Iraqi Freedom. We had been fighting for a couple of days. We had made a significant maneuver to get north. But we're about to take on one of the most difficult and dangerous missions of the Iraq invasion. Because of the terrain and what we had to do to get an armored division through a small space, this was very, very difficult, very risky. Late at night, on the evening prior to the movement, I was in the Tactical Operations Center, or what we refer to as a TOC, and I was on the radio issuing orders and directing subordinate commanders. And so the operations center was a flurry of activity, and the mood was extremely tense. You see, because I was directing the maneuver of the forces, my small operations center was well forward on the leading edge of the battlefield. And so there was a lot of activity outside of the tent. There's also a flurry of activity ongoing inside of the tent. In fact, you could cut the anxiety with a knife. And again, I was very focused on what I was doing. So on the radio, talking to my subordinate commanders, very busy, very, very focused. And then at one point I looked up and I realized that all the eyes in the operations center were on me, and there was near total quiet. In fact, there wasn't a sound in the room beyond the radio transmissions and a steady beat of artillery just beyond the walls of the tent. The troops that were assembled in the op center, they had stopped what they were doing and they were watching me intently. They were waiting to hear what I had to say. Again, I thought back to that advice that Sergeant First Class Fox Ballard had given me all those many years ago. And I wanted to convey to the folks on the team that I would be with them, leading them, and I would take care of them. I also wanted them to know that we had a plan, a good plan, and that I was confident in the plan and confident that we would be successful in executing that plan. We had trained incredibly hard for that very moment. Indeed, there wasn't a force in the world that was better trained or better equipped or more ready than we were. And I told them as much. And they trusted what I was telling them. And again, that trust was not based only on my words, in what I said to them. But they were also watching my actions, my body language. They were watching me very closely. And the fact that they saw me as both competent and confident, that gave them confidence. It was truly a humbling moment. The third piece of advice that I would offer you is to always strive to be a team player. In all that you do, look for ways to enable others' success. And you will quickly discover that that is often the best way to achieve a team's objectives. You know, President Ronald Reagan kept a small plaque on his desk in the Oval Office with the words, "There is no limit to what a man can do or where he can go if he doesn't mind who gets the credit," end of quote. And I just got to tell you that I believe that's absolutely true. In the military, we conduct operations and we fight as a team. Ours is a team sport. And the fact is that most professions place a premium on teamwork. And so my advice to you is to seek to contribute your unique talents and your energies towards supporting and enabling the team's objectives. Put your oar in the water and row hard. And oh, by the way, when you are a team player, and when you are someone who makes a point to enable and empower others, you'll find that something magical happens. You'll find that people will routinely seek you out, and they'll want you to be on their team. And so you become the most valuable player. You know, back in 2008, I was serving as a commander of the multinational corps, Iraq. And we had about 160,000 of the world's finest soldiers deployed to Iraq under my command. It was a period after the surge, and we were required to maintain stability throughout the country of Iraq, while at the same time drawing down the number of U.S. forces on the ground. And one of the major challenges that we were faced with at the time was that of Shia militias. Now, most of these militias were backed by Iran, and they operated independent of the government of Iraq. They were generally very disruptive, and they posed a significant threat to our forces. In one area in particular, Basra province, which is in the southern part of the country, was essentially controlled by these Iranian-backed Shia militias. And Basra was an important location because it was where Iraq, most of Iraq's oil reserves were located. And again, the government wasn't able to exert any real control there. In fact, at the time, the Iraqi security forces were challenged to project combat power outside of the main population centers, namely Baghdad. And so, as you would imagine, the government was hesitant to take on these Shia militias. Then one day, the prime minister at the time, Nouri al-Maliki, Prime Minister al-Maliki decided on his own that he was going to go to Basra and take a stand against the militias. And in doing so, he was going to exert control and send a strong message to the militias and to the people of Iraq that he was in fact in charge. And so again, without telling us about his plans, he hastily assembled a force, he headed down to Basra, and immediately they got embroiled in a fight with the Shia militias, the Mahdi army. And they were wholly unprepared for that fight. The fact is, they had no real plan, and they had limited capability and very limited experience. And they quickly found themselves involved in a very dangerous situation, and one that was rapidly getting worse. And so once I discovered what had happened, I watched the situation develop, and my instinct told me that I needed to personally go down to Basra and assess the situation. And so I pulled together a team, and we flew down there. And once we were on the ground, we linked up with the Prime Minister and took stock of the situation. And it was very, very dire. But I assured Maliki that we would help them, and I assured him that he, not us, would get all of the credit if we were successful. And there was no doubt in my mind that we would be successful. And so we proceeded to embed some of our forces with the Iraqi security forces. We helped them to develop a plan, we called in fire support, and we helped the Prime Minister and his team to get out of what was potentially a disastrous situation. And again, we made sure that he got 100% of the credit for all of it. And in the end, he was able to wrest control of the city of Basra from the militia. And he was also able to stabilize the southern part of the country. And in the process, garner some much needed support throughout the rest of that country. It was indeed a high watermark for the Prime Minister and his supporters. Unfortunately, as we know, Maliki would go on to make some very poor decisions in subsequent years, and he ultimately squandered the opportunity that we'd given him. But at the time, the operation known as Charge of the Knights was a very good example, in my opinion, of how you can effectively accomplish the team's objectives by enabling and empowering others' success. The next piece of advice that I would give you is don't be consumed with climbing the ladder. It's good to have goals. You must have goals. But you know, too often people map out their careers and say to themselves, okay, I got to get this particular job and do this for this long. I've got to get this kind of report in order to get this next job. And if I do, by the time I'm 30, I'll hold this job. And so forth and so on. Trust me, folks, I've been around for a long time. And I can assure you that, first of all, most of the times, things don't work the way that you plan. And second, if you remember what old Fox Ballard told me, and you focus on taking care of your people and doing the job that you've been given while doing it better than anybody else has ever done it, if you focus on those things rather than worrying about your next job, I promise you that you will be successful, enormously successful. But you need to be patient. You know, I joined the Army as a brand new second lieutenant in 1975. The Vietnam War was just ending, and many of the troops that I was tasked with leading and the non-commissioned officers and senior officers in my unit had spent a good bit of time in combat. And so I was anxious to do the same. But in the end, 20 plus years passed before I had the opportunity to lead troops in combat. Almost 30 years. And when I helped to lead the invasion into Iraq in March of 2003, I was a one-star general. Of course, I spent a whole lot of time in combat since that time, with three tours in Iraq and one in Afghanistan. And so my advice to you is to be patient. St. Augustine wrote that patience is the companion of wisdom. And I do believe this to be an accurate statement. Trust me, your time will come. And of course, you do need to make sure that you are ready, both mentally and physically, ready to take advantage of opportunities as they present themselves. And so you need to do the necessary reps and sets now to ensure that you are ready when the time comes. Now, and these are my last few nuggets of advice that I'll share with you. The first is to be willing to take risks. Wander outside your comfort zone every now and then. Pursue unique opportunities. Take on new challenges. Learn a language. If you can do it, spend some time abroad. Take an occasional assignment that is perhaps outside of your traditional career field, and thereby endeavor to broaden your horizons. But most important, commit yourself to lifelong learning. You know, that has been one of the keys to any success that I have achieved over the course of my career. At an early age, I committed myself to lifelong learning. And I will seek advice from my mentors no matter how old I get. In fact, just last week I was in Washington, D.C. for congressional testimony. And before leaving the city, I spent about an hour and a half or so with one of my mentors, a guy by the name of Colin Powell. You may have heard of him. You know, every time that I go see General Powell, he scouts me up. But in the end, I'm always better for it. And he's always right. And for a man like that, who is as busy as he is, to take time to spend with me frequently, I think is an enormous, just an enormous gift. And so I appreciate every opportunity. But it's not just General Powell, it's guys like Henry Kissinger, who I spent time with, and Francis Hesselbein, and so many others that really are interested in helping to shape leaders. Finally, I would say to you, always push yourself to be better tomorrow than you were today. You know, I put this uniform on every day for nearly 41 years. Before going to bed each night, I ask myself two questions. The first is, did I do the right things today? And the second is, did I do everything possible to take care of those individuals who were placed in my charge? And if the answer is no to either one of those questions, then I commit myself to trying to do better the next day. And you do need to be prepared to learn from your mistakes. We all make mistakes. You know, John Wooden, the famed coach of the UCLA basketball team, arguably said it best when he said, if you're not making mistakes, then you're not doing anything. I'm positive that a doer makes mistakes, end of quote. And so, It's okay to occasionally make mistakes, but you must take care to learn from them and learn from mistakes made by others as well. And so, ladies and gentlemen, my advice to you this afternoon is really pretty simple. Work hard. Take each job and each opportunity as it comes. Always give whatever you do 100% of your effort. Do the necessary reps and sets now to master your craft. Take care of your people. Be a team player. Look to enable others' success. And all that you do, never, never, never compromise your values. You know, the one thing that will have the greatest influence on your life is the strength of your character. As a famed African-American leader, Booker T. Washington, once stated, character, not circumstance, makes the person, end of quote. And the character of every individual is a reflection of his or her values. Those values serve as guideposts in our lives. Indeed, strong values are the cornerstone of the Auburn Creed. They are the bedrock upon which this great institution is built. And so, if you do all of those things, I believe that you can feel confident that the right opportunities will present themselves at the appropriate times. And you will be incredibly successful. Successful in your personal and your professional lives. You are building a tremendous foundation here at Auburn. A foundation that is based upon strong values and intellectual rigor and a wonderful, wonderful network of friends and mentors and fellow alumni. Take advantage of this great opportunity. Treasure the experience. It will serve you well in the future. And finally, always, in all that you do, always strive to make a positive difference through your individual and collective efforts. And by doing so, you will help to make our world a better place. I want to thank you again for the opportunity to join you here today, and with that, I'll be happy to answer a few of your questions here. So, what questions? Yes, sir. Please, go ahead.
I'm Tony Eschew here at Auburn University, ROTC. I have a question for you, sir, regarding the difference between strategic level and your other levels of leadership from platoon to division. How do you feel the leadership challenge between strategic level with the heads of state that you deal with and foreign diplomats are similar and different from those other levels that you dealt with from platoon to division?
Thanks. That's a great question. Please have a seat. As a combatant commander, you really are one of the key representatives for the United States of America in the part of the world that you work in. And I would tell you that over the last 3 months, as I've gone around and visited countries in my region, I've had the ability to sit down with a number of presidents and kings and emirs and ministers of defense, the people that are at the very top of the food chain in all of these countries. I spent an hour and a half with President El-Sisi in Egypt a couple of weeks ago, the king of Saudi Arabia, the king of Jordan, the king of Bahrain. You as a combatant commander represent a lot in terms of the United States of America, and they look to you to kind of transmit what our policy is and what our goals and objectives are for the region. They also look for us to reassure them that we're going to be their partners in the region going forward. So how is this different operating, at this level? Well, at the tactical level, operational level, you get clear-cut tactical goals and objectives, and things are pretty easy. When you get to the strategic level, and by the way, I work for the Secretary of Defense, the next guy in the food chain is President of the United States. And so the people that I deal with on a daily basis are those two guys. And what you find is there are no clear-cut solutions to anything at this level. And you'll find yourself managing crises, and certainly in the central region, in the Middle East, you get a new crisis just about every day. But nothing is simple. And so you have to take policy, as outlined by our strategic leaders, the President, Secretary of Defense, and then translate that policy into meaningful goals and objectives, military goals and objectives, that our men and women in uniform can accomplish. And you also recognize that at this level that the military is not the answer for everything. And so as you're working various problems, you're trying to find ways to incorporate other agencies in the solution set. And so, you become very good friends with folks in the intel community, and I've known General Burgess for a long time, and trust me, you have a real gem in this general. And he's a very, very humble guy, but this guy controlled all of the intelligence efforts for the military in the United States of America. And so there's a lot of knowledge and expertise in general purpose. And I think, again, I think you're really lucky to have it. But at this level, you're really looking to integrate various agencies as a part of the solution set. And let me just give you a flavor of how complicated things are at this level. You know, I mean, every day you're watching the Syria conflict on television. And sometimes, you know, you gotta be careful about what you see on television from time to time, because, you know, you only get part of the picture. And sometimes things can be confusing because they seem pretty simple and straightforward. You know, and you kind of wonder, hey, how come we can't get this Syria thing over, like, tomorrow? You know, what's going on here? Well, let me just, well, you kind of believe that it's a, you know, pretty straightforward problem set. But the Syria conflict is not a shirts and skins game. You know, if you just look at the players that are on the battlefield, you have the Syrian regime, you have the Russians, you have the Turks, you have the Syrian Kurds, and there's two flavors of them, one being supported by the Russians and one flavor of them we're working with. You have ISIL, you have Iran, Lebanese Hezbollah, you have moderate Syrian opposition forces, and there's about 100 different types of those guys, and then some other flavors of guys. And so all these guys are interacting with each other, fighting each other in a very constrained battle space. And so that's part of the deal that you don't see on television every night, because it really is too complex for anybody to try to explain. But it is what your country, what your leadership is trying to sort through. And again, it is so complex that there is no military, no kinetic solution to that. There's got to be a diplomatic or a political solution to that. And thankfully, we have now a cessation of hostilities in Syria, and it's held for longer than people thought it would. Hopefully, it will begin to set the stage for a political or a diplomatic solution. Next question, please. Okay, I'm going to start asking you guys questions if you don't answer. What's on your mind?
Captain Williams, Auburn ROTC. On your illustrious career that you get in 41 years, after your career is over, what are your plans on doing after that?
You know, I'm always thanks. I've always told people over the last 41 years that when I get out of the Army, I'm going to open a bait shop, you know, sell fish bait. But then I started thinking about this seriously here in the last couple of days. And if I open a bait shop, and I got to make a decision as to whether I should keep live worms and minnows. But then I got to worry about keeping them alive. That's too much to deal with. So maybe just selling lures. Then I got to keep inventory, so that's too much. So I'm not sure about this bait shop anymore. Truth be known, the job I have now, you can't take time to figure out what you're going to do in the future. And so what I'll do is pretty much what General Burgess did, because he had a tough job, is I'll take some time after I retire and figure out what the next steps are going to be. You know, there's lots of wars to be fought, and if you consider the homeless rate, illiteracy, poverty, you know, cancer, all those kinds of worthy causes, there's lots of wars to be fought out there, and I'm sure that one or more of those wars could use an old, rusty, retired soldier, so we'll see what happens. I saw another hand back there. Yes, sir.
Sir, I'm from Captain Trinity Caldwell, battlefield veteran, as you already mentioned. Can you speak to the current reduction in forces and the extreme restoration with respect to war fighting and policy and strategic level? War has always been a human endeavor, and right now we're using drones, and that's great. But just can you elaborate on how the extreme restoration is affecting your policy?
Yeah, Yeah, you know, I used to be the vice chief of staff in the Army. And when you're the chief of staff and the vice chief of staff in the Army, you're always focused on, your job is to man, train, and equip the force. And you're always striking a delicate balance between, you know, you got whatever amount of money you have to invest in your service, you got to strike a balance between spending money to make sure that the force is ready. You have to make sure that you invest in future technology so that you maintain the appropriate edge in the next fight. And then you got to make sure that you're comfortable with the size of the force. Is a force going to be big enough so that you can address all the challenges that you're going to be faced with in the days going forward? After every conflict, you go back and check the history, it goes way back to almost the beginning of our country. After every major conflict, you know, it's our natural tendency, you know, our America's natural tendency to say, okay, we don't need a big military, so we need to downsize and get as small as, just keep exactly what we need. Well, we've been wrong 100% of the time. There's an assumption that, you know, it's easy to grow soldiers, so we can, you know, have a small number of soldiers, and then when we face a war, we can get big in a hurry. In my mind, that's not a good assumption, because, you know, what makes us different is that we have the best man and woman on the battlefield in the world. Our non-commissioned officers in our military, no matter what the service, you know, they could run armies in some other countries in the world. I have no question about that. But in order to maintain a force like that, those kinds of people, then you know you gotta be able to train them and equip them and keep enough on board to make sure that you know you can keep the training going and also meet your requirements on a daily basis. We're headed now to something. We're about in the Army. I think you're at 460,000 right now. And you're going a bit more than that. As Vice Chief of the Army, I got uncomfortable whenever we got below 500,000. We want to keep just what we need to meet all our requirements and keep and maintain the edge, keep the best fighting force in the world. But and we don't want excess. But I think when you get, you know, where we are right now, it's a bit uncomfortable. I hope I got to your question. Next question. Yes, sir.
General Alston, Paul Harris, Department of Political Science. And I want you to maybe go back to when you were a second LT in 75 in Germany, and you remember that time. And now here we are, 40 years later. We've got this reduction in force here. We've got so many demands on what's happening here. And what kind of advice can you give? What advice can you give to policymakers to say that in fact, you know, that there's importance to have this force protection here? Right now we're looking at shifting our resources back to Europe because these threats are still there. And what kind of advice would you give policymakers on this?
You know, I, along with the other four-star general and flag officers in the military, routinely give advice on you know, what we think is what we need to be concerned about. I think the world today is very, very unpredictable. I think that we're going to be challenged for some time to come. If you look at the world, the part of the world that I deal with on a daily basis, the Middle East, I can tell you that we're going to defeat ISIL in Iraq and Syria, but it ain't going to be over. I mean, they're going to morph, they're going to change into something else, and we're going to have to be able to deal with that. This is a movement, and not necessarily just a simple organization. And it's an idea. We're going to have to defeat that idea going forward. So this is going to take us and others in the international community to go after. So, you know, 10 years ago, 5 years ago, 4 years ago, we didn't see ISIL or Daesh on the horizon. Okay, so what is the next piece out here? And I would tell you, 4 years ago, we also didn't anticipate we'd see a rambunctious Mr. Putin enter the scene with Russia, who has begun to kind of push the edge here a bit, and he wants to demonstrate that he isn't, that Russia is in fact a world power. And I mean, that's great. They have the economy, I think, of the size of Italy, but they want to be a world power nonetheless. And it is, I mean, it's the truth. It's a small economy. And so they cannot afford to do the types of things that you're doing, you're seeing them do in Syria for, you know, a very long time. So what's next on the horizon? Well, we think that, you know, you could see some challenges from nation states, Russia, China. But you have to also be able to deal with what we've seen for organizations like ISIL or Daesh. Again, this is not over, and we're going to have to do more to take away the underlying causes that allowed Daesh to that gave rise to Daesh. And what are those underlying causes? Well, when I was here last back in November, I kind of outlined some of the things. The sectarian tension that we see in the region is greater than we've ever seen it before. There's a struggle in the religion between the moderates and the extremists. You know, the folks in the region are going to have to go after that and fix that. We can't, as Westerners, fix that. There's a youth bulge in the region. And so this is legions of young people that are educated and unemployed or underemployed, and they are very ripe to be recruited by elements like Al-Qaeda or ISIL. So the folks in the region are going to have to deal with that, and we're going to have to help them deal with it. And we're also going to have to help them create the mechanisms to provide for the security and stability inside their sovereign spaces. Our goal is to help them build the capability to do this for themselves so that we don't have to do it, because we can't do it for everybody. And we've made some progress, but there's still a lot more to be done. Thanks for a great question, sir. One more question. I'll come over to you, sir.
Sir,
Major Steele,
I'm
there,
Professor of Military Science. So I have a couple of students that are going to be graduating in May and also commissioning. What, in addition to your 5 points you've made, what advice would you give them as newly second lieutenant entering the military?
So the question was, for those of you who didn't hear it, there are some aspiring young men and women sitting in the third row up here who are about to graduate and at some point go off and start their careers, and they're ready to get going here. And what advice would I give to them? Well, turn back now. I'm just kidding. Hey, listen. Listen, if I... Nobody go out and quote me. I love what I do. And if I could be you, I would do everything that I've already done. I'd do it the same way. You know, to be a part of a winning team, it, you can't replace that. And so, every day that you wear this uniform, you're on the world's greatest team. Every day is not going to be a perfect day, but every day is going to be a pretty good day when you can stand in the ranks of some folks who will inspire you in just about every endeavor. I mentioned earlier that it's important to focus on the right things, and the right things, the most important thing is to take care of those folks that you're leading. So we put you through all of this to make you a leader, not a follower. And you're going to question whether or not you can stand in front of those folks who have been to Iraq and been to Afghanistan, and you just came out of school. Am I worthy? Can I do this? You betcha you can do it. There's a reason that we invested all of this in you, because you're going to be great leaders. And don't hesitate one second. Listen to those folks that you're working with, They want you to receive their input, but at the end of the day, you're going to be the leader that has to make the decisions, even as lieutenants, and you're going to do a great job. I have zero concerns about that. But again, I would emphasize, take care of your people and be willing to learn. Be a lifelong learner. And even when there's an old guy like me giving you advice, not everything will apply to you, but there are some pretty good nuggets out there. When a guy like Colin Powell or Francis Hesselbein speaks to me, or Henry Kissing, I was, by the way, Francis Hesselbein is a, she's been a student of leadership all of her life. She's a person that saved the Girl Scouts back many years ago. The Girl Scouts were about to go under, and Francis came along and pulled them out of the depths there. She's a Presidential Medal of Freedom Award winner. She's 100 years old. 100, about to be 101, I guess. And one of my heroes. And she goes to work every day. And she loves the United States military because it creates people like you. And she is passionate about what she does. So people like that, you know, enable people like us. So when you get advice from those kinds of people, be willing to listen. Again, not everything will apply to you, but take those nuggets that do. Sir, I'm sorry. Go ahead, please.
Thank you. I have a question about, I'm drawing a parallel. You know, a couple hundred years ago, the British Empire had the largest, strongest armies in the world. When they encountered the colonial militias, we were on our own turf. We didn't follow their rules of engagement, and were able to cripple this large superpower. Today, it seems that we as a country are the large superpower, and some of the enemies that we face around the world, as you mentioned, in this complex area, are very crafty, very creative. In terms of strategic initiatives and strategic thinking, what kinds of strategic thinking outside of our traditional conventional warfare do you see as necessary to be more effective?
Well, thanks, sir. That's a great question. I think, first of all, you have to endeavor to understand the nature of the problem. And you have to recognize when change has taken place. The enemies that we face now are not, I mean, they are pretty sophisticated. Many of these folks aren't PhDs, some of them are, but they have learned to use the tools that are available to them, unlike any adversary that you've ever faced. If you just look at the, you know, the way that they're using cyberspace, if you look at some of the things they're doing in advertising their organization, you look at the way, what they're doing to make money. You know, ISIL realized early on that this business takes money, and so in order to be successful, they had to generate a lot of revenue, and they went about it, you know, in a very sophisticated way. So what do we have to do? Well, we recognize that it takes money as well. So I think the first thing we have to do is recognize that we have to work as a part of an international element. We can't do this by ourselves, nor do we want to be a colonial element. And we'll tell you right away that we want that country, whatever it is, Iraq or Syria or whatever it is, to one day be able to do this themselves. And so we're going to enable you, but you got to do it yourself. You got to stand up the right amount of security forces and do the right thing. So working as a part of an international element, we need to make sure that we take away the adversary's means to resource themselves. And we also have to take away the ability to move foreign fighters around the globe. And this is a very, very sophisticated network as well. And every day that we go after these networks, we learn more about them. Our strategic intelligence should lead us to the right places to help us understand what's next on the horizon. And then we have to make sure that we're doing the right things to disallow these elements, to generate resources, and to generate manpower in terms of foreign fighters. I think more and more we're realizing that you do have to, you know, get elements like Cyber Command and the Treasury Department and others to be a part of your effort. It is not just military effort. The final piece is what underpins all of this is, political problems. So if you don't get the politics right at the end of the day, then no matter what you do to fix it militarily, you could find yourself back in the same space again in the future. Iraq is a good example of that. If the Iraqis don't find a way to be inclusive of the Sunnis and the Kurds in Iraq, then no matter what we do in defeating ISIL, son of ISIL is going to come, or ISIL 2.0 will show up a couple of years from now. And so we want to see, we want to be able to put fixes in place that are more permanent in nature than what we've seen in the past. Okay. Great question, sir. All right, last one.
Sir, Lieutenant Colonel Redfield, I'm the Director of Strategic Planning for the Alabama Guard. Currently attending Army War College, and I'm learning how to shift from being an operational commander and leader planner into becoming the strategic plans guy. What's a good piece of advice for somebody to get to that new mindset of being at brigade and below level and learning to plan at a much higher level?
Yeah, I think there's some great things to look at right now that can give you some good clues as to the types of things that you'll have to master to be able to deal with taking policy and translating policy into meaningful goals and objectives that troops can accomplish. And so the Iraq and Syria conflict is one of those. You can watch, you can take a look at what's going on in the Yemen conflict. As you know, the Saudis are leading that coalition. First time ever for them to lead a coalition. And they're finding it very, very difficult, as you would imagine. We are a part of that coalition. We are not leading. There's Afghanistan and Pakistan. What are the national goals? What are the core interests, what's important to us, and what are we willing to do to protect those interests? So I think there's some case studies out there that, just kind of looking at from top to bottom how decisions have been made and what challenges have we been faced with are good templates for you to look at and say, okay, these are kind of things I'm going to be dealing with in the future, and maybe you may even want to talk to some folks who are on a joint staff right now or dealing with some of those issues currently. I know it's late in the afternoon and I'm the only thing between you and freedom, and so I'm going to get off the stage, but it has been a real pleasure to be able to come and spend a little time with you. And again, to the faculty here, thanks so much for what you do to promote the interest of not only in this great institution, but really to develop young men and women of character who go out and represent you throughout the world. There are Auburn graduates all over the world doing great things.